I've been collecting cameras practically my entire life. Probably because of my grandfather. I got his Polaroid 95 sitting up there on the table. Whenever we went to Florida, he had an old, well, it was a new Cadillac then, but now it's old, but he had a Cadillac, and that camera and a Minox of all sizes sat next to him in the front seat, okay? And he would get out of the car and he'd pull that Polaroid out and he'd take a picture. And so I know there was something inherent in doing that, or in that. And my mom, oh my God, my mom took black and whites of me with her Argus camera. Just, I'm an only child, so they were just, oh look, he picked his nose, boom, take a picture, you know. So it was always interesting there. So I was always getting my picture taken, and then I decided that perhaps I should start collecting cameras as a hobby, which I did. That's me at a tractor show. In fact, I'll be at that tractor show next week. That's one of the cameras I shoot with at the show. It's a 4x5 geared orf with a 120 back on it, so I can process the film easily at home now without a darkroom. That is Napisa's first photograph. That's the first photograph in the world, believe it or not. And it was done on a piece of asphalt, tin-plated asphalt, asphalt-plated tin. There was a lot of experimentation in the early days trying to find out what was sensitive to light. And if you saw the real print, you'd go, huh? Because it is so dark. You have to hold it at just the right angle with just the right light hitting it so it reflects back into your eyes and you can see it. When I was looking for pictures for this presentation, I was looking for that one, and I found all sorts of renditions of it, all sorts of copies that had been made, and that was about the best. Even when it was new, it was not good, but it was an experiment, and they were trying to find the fact that asphalt was light sensitive. Who would have known?
What year?
1826. Yeah. The next design was a daguerreotype, and daguerreotypes came in the 1830s. They were notoriously dangerous cameras to use. Actually, the camera itself wasn't dangerous; it was the process. You took a copper plate, you polished it to a mirror finish, you put a silver coating on it. You took the picture, which could take anywhere from 10 to 45 minutes for the exposure. Okay, it wasn't fast film, it was really slow. And then you had a box called a fuming box. And a fuming box had a container, had a little burner, alcohol burner, and above that burner was a tray of mercury. So you're heating mercury up, getting the fumes of that going into your lungs, and it would develop the image. The mercury actually bonded with the silver, and that's what caused the image. Now this is also, it's a direct positive, which means that when you look at the picture, it's actually backwards from the way it actually would be. So if a guy parted his hair on the left in real life, in the photograph it would be on the right. So it was a direct positive. Oh God, yeah, I've seen lots of daguerreotype cameras. I've seen probably, oh yeah, sure, you can still pick them up at antique stores. They are ones that are really hard to look at. You have to wiggle them back and forth. They're very silvery. And once you get an image that is right, it glows at you. They're beautiful images. The unfortunate thing is that at antique malls and stores and stuff, when you find a daguerreotype, you're finding the worst ones now. All the good ones have been collected. They really have. They're all gone. This is a daguerreotype that Samuel F.B. Morse built along with Daguerre. And Morse, of course, was the Morse code. He had a very early interest in photography, And that's something that he built. There was no factories building these things. These are cabinet buildings. So he came up with a design and got a lens from one of the opticians and produced a camera. That is the first daguerreotype ever done out a window, because it's so bright, you had a short exposure. It is also the first portrait of a person ever. Doesn't look like there's a person in that picture, but there they are. 1837. Yeah, of course, the clothing. 1/100 of a second or a ton. Oh, that there? He was probably experimenting. We don't know if that's really the first one, but it he could have taken 10 that day and experimented and threw the rest away. Okay. Edison, they always say, you know, Edison invented light bulb. No, he didn't invent it. He perfected it. He made it better. There was a light bulb that worked on electricity before. But the one that's in the Smithsonian isn't the one that he used, because he broke the one that he made that lasted for 40 hours to see why it lasted. Same thing with the daguerreotype camera, where we take images. He threw them out. We don't know. Everybody has a family member who had a box camera. And that is probably the prevalent camera design of all time. That's a Kodak, probably a number 2A. Takes 120 film, still available, which is kind of neat. I was going to bring my number 2 Kodak, and I couldn't bring it. What I started saying is, boxes were the easiest thing to make. Okay, and that's why cameras are, for the most part, just a big box in the early days. When George Eastman started out making film, dry plates for photographers, he then decided I should make a camera and sell the whole process. And his process was, you bought the camera, it was loaded with enough film for 100 images. Then you sent the camera back to Kodak, they would process it and send you the camera reloaded and the pictures back, and you're ready to go again. Now, the most difficult part of this, do any of you guys have kids, or maybe you did it yourself, build models and you put decals on models? Mm-hmm. And the decal is real flimsy, right? Mm-hmm. Well, the film on those days was the silver nitrate-based emulsion was coated on paper. And there was mucilage or horse hide glue between the two. And they would go into the processing lab, and it was all women who ran this because they were gentle. They could do it, or at least George Eastman said they had the patience for the work. Anyway, the paper would be stripped away, and this negative, which is now just kind of this mass of floating, almost like floating goo, would be then laid onto a piece of cellulose nitrate sheet, and then it would be processed and dried, and then they would make a contact print from it. And they were round on those early ones. And that happens to be George Eastman taking a picture of somebody else who was taking a picture of George. That is, without a doubt, one of the coolest cameras that has ever been found. The guy who got this, it's the way it was when it was shipped. It's brand new. And it's from 1887. And it's just phenomenal. So they had the little red dot on the front hid or covered the lens that was used for the viewfinder. The little felt lens cap on the front, that of course covered the lens. And then there was a winder and the little brass top ring on the top that had a counter in it, and you could see what your count was. Their logo or their slogan back then was, "You pull the string, we do the rest." That happens to be my number 2.
I took a picture of it ages ago, and I got no clue where it went to. But anyway, same type of camera. It took about a 3-inch diameter image, and it took 60 pictures instead of 100. Now, industrial design. I love industrial design. And box cameras had, instead of making it just a plain ordinary box, like that very first picture of box camera, they started, especially in the 30s and the late 20s, doing the Art Deco thing. And Agfa was the first one to do it. Oh, sorry, that's also an Ansco camera. That's an early one from the 1870s. Yeah, see how this is. Okay, more Ansco camera. I'm doing eight, I remember. That one, yeah, that one took sheet film. You could, that took a rectangular picture. It has two view windows on it, so you can turn the camera 90 degrees and take a horizontal over. That is an Ansco multiplier camera. If you wanted, how many is that? Yeah, that's 3, 6, 9, 12, 15. If you want 15 pictures of something, you got one of those. Yeah. Now we go to Argus. Argus cameras were made by a company in Michigan that made radios first. And then they went into cameras. And one of their first cameras was this. And it's Art Deco in its looks. It's got the three lines on it. On the Bakelite on the front there, you'll see those three ridges. That's seen everywhere in the 1900s, or in the 30s. Everything from buildings to bridges, there's three bands going by. Three was supposedly a very pleasing thing to look at, and in the Art Deco world. So this is an Art Deco camera that Argus did. A camera that was made by Argus, called a Delco 828. It took 828 roll film. Streamlined. You know, that it does. It looks like it's going fast. Another Argus. Backside of it, neat design on the back. A colored one. Made out of brown Bakelite and gold, not gold, brass-plated parts. Kind of rare. You know, like when you collect cameras, you're always looking for a rare one, and this is definitely one of those. Oh, yeah. Oh, my gosh, yes. Yeah, there were hundreds of manufacturers of cheap cameras that did Bakelite. Argus had a camera called a C4. This is a C4 here. Oops, back end of another one of those Art Deco ones. Again, it looks like it's moving. It looks like it belongs on a streamlined train. It's really cool looking. And then they come up with that thing. Okay, that is a C1. I can't really describe why they went from something that looked like that to that, okay? But they sold literally millions of them. Somewhere around 3.5 million of those cameras were sold. Everybody had one. I had a guy when I worked in a camera shop in Valpo, Gordy Schultz was his name. Gordy was a amputee from World War II. And Gordy was always the winner in the slideshow contest at the camera club. He took great pictures. He really did. They were wonderful photographs. And he shot them with an Argus C3. He could do everything, hold it and fire it with one hand, no problem. Then his family decided he needed a new camera. So they get him a Canon SureShot, which is an autofocus, auto-advanced camera, and he hated it. I built a rig for Gordy that held three of those Argus C3s on top of each other with room for his hand to get in there to wind it. One for black and white, one for color negatives, and one for color slides. He was nuts over them. That's one with a rangefinder on it that's connected. Another Art Deco camera, rival. A lot of companies after World War II, GIs would come home, they would get a loan for a business, they'd make a camera, make something, and then they would undercapitalize themselves and go out of business. And that's one. That's an example of that. Now we're hitting into some of the bigger cameras. That camera there is actually quite large. It's probably 18 inches long, 9 inches wide, and believe it or not, it's called a detective camera. Okay? And they made them in black. That's one of mine. I like the wood one better. They made them in they supposedly, the deal was that you're walking around with this thing, it looks like you're carrying a wood box and not a camera, okay? But they've gotten the name detective camera, which just has always cracked me up. This is one I picked up at a flea market somewhere for $5. I've recovered it. It's all nice and new, nice looking now. That's another rather large box camera. It stands about, oh gosh, about that tall. It's big. It takes 130 film. It takes 5 instead of 8 pictures per roll.
Have you taken photographs of all the cameras?
I've had, in my collection, I've had 1,500 cameras. So the answer is no.
Some didn't.
No, they all work. I make sure they all work. I play with them and make and fix them and make sure they're operable. But it's just pointless to, I started buying when I was young, and I got less than 1,000 now. I sold them. That's what I put my kids through college with. Another type of detective camera, big thing. I like the looks of that because it's got knobs on it. You know, got these big knobs, and what do you do with them? Cute, that's a term I don't think they ever thought they would use. The rare cameras are the ones that were finished in all wood. They normally are leather covered. Some of them were called ordinary because they weren't fancy. Leather made them fancy. I don't know why the companies did it. There's really never been an explanation to why they made a camera that was a wood finish on it. Now we're getting into more Art Deco type cameras. This company was the Ciro company, and everything they made had nice round edges to it. Smooth edges, nothing, no sharp things anywhere. And this one here, I zoom in on that. This is a black version that is kind of rare. You don't see them too often. In fact, you don't see them now at all. And they made twin lens reflexes. This is the viewing lens here, and it had a mirror in it that aimed up to a ground glass screen. And you looked in the top, and you looked at your image, and then you shot the picture with the taking lens. And hopefully the two matched. Now, after World War II, the Zeiss company in Germany had a real bad problem. The Russians came in before the war was over and really stripped out the Zeiss company in Stuttgart and took everything to Russia. To be made into cameras. So there are cameras after World War II that are called no-name contacts. So that name contacts on the front there didn't exist. It was just a blank plate. The interesting thing is when you take that whole front off, on the back side, you can see the word contacts because when the stamping die came down, they didn't take and fill in the bottom of the plate. just the top one, they ground off the work contacts. So you could tell where that camera was from. There's always a big deal whether or not Leica lenses were sharper or Zeiss lenses were sharper. The deal was that the Zeiss lenses were sharper, but the Leica lenses had better contrast. Now we get into design. Now, I love trains, as we all know. That locomotive was designed by Henry Dreyfuss. And Henry Dreyfuss also designed that camera, the Honeywell thermometer, or the thermostat, the John Deere tractor. Oh, yeah. In fact, that ridge on top, see where the steering wheel shaft goes into the body? That ridge on top has an angle to it. It's approximately 170 or 180 degrees, which is the same angle as an old Bell telephone hand unit. Okay, that angle on the top there. Same design. He also designed the Polaroid 95, the Polaroid SX70. And if you notice, these differ from, they're about 30 years apart. That's 1946, 47, and this is 1977. But you notice a similarity? Brown leather, brushed metal finish. He designed a pencil sharpener. Now, oh, I'm sorry, Raymond Loewy designed this. Now we're getting into Raymond Loewy stuff. Raymond Loewy designed railroad engines, just like Dreyfuss did. He designed a pencil sharpener that looks like it's moving without moving. He designed the Ansco Flex 2 and the 1, and the Model 1. Again, everything has a nice smooth lines to it. Smooth edges, you don't feel anything. It's just a comfortable camera to shoot with. Designed the truck, and Raymond Loewy designed the Coca-Cola logo. And there he is on one of his locomotives, the Pennsy S1. And he did that thing. I'm not sure if I like it. I've got one somewhere, and it's kind of an oddball camera. The Avante, made by Studebaker over in South Bend. He designed that. Now we get into Teague. Teague was another industrial designer. He loved Art Deco. And that camera, even though it's an all black, I got a new one there sitting on the table, I'll show you in a little bit. Even though it's all black, it looks smooth. It looks like it's really going fast. The deal was that Kodak, the company by then, George Eastman had been dead for a couple years at this point. They, like today, don't think people, they want somebody to look at a camera, buy a camera, because it looks neat. And you don't do that. You find out how good the optics are. If the optics are good, then you buy it. But because that was a neat and slick looking camera, they sold thousands of them. Hundreds of thousands of them. That was a Bakelite camera. I think the production was upwards of almost a million. That's another one. That's my, that, isn't that neat? I got my dad's up there. And that has a really cool story. Teague designed it during the war, or before the war. The war came, and they were getting about 10,000 shutter units and lenses from Germany. And a U-boat sunk the ship that the lenses and shutters were on. So Kodak had to real quickly come up with their own shutter called a Supermatic, and a lens that wasn't really supposed to be on the camera. It was sort of a top secret lens that was very bright. It's an F2 lens, and they got it on the camera. Another Teague design, that was the first automatic camera ever built, automatic aperture, Kodak Super 620. Nobody can afford one of those. They show up occasionally on eBay, and they're always 10 grand. another Teague design, the car and the gas station, and the gas pumps, all his. So industrial design is a big deal in photography. Isn't that neat? Yep, that's a wood presentation box that's been lacquered, and the camera on top of it. Yeah. Now we get into some of the off-brand sort of. This is a Detrola. Any idea where that was made? Hey, good for you. Another Bakelite camera. These were called mini cams. They took, They took either 35 millimeter or the slightly bigger one took 127 roll film. That one's got a 2-inch lens, so that's a 35. Well, actually, you can tell because it's got a winding knob and a pickup knob. Exactus, that was my first camera. And I had to have one because I was born left-handed. It switched to right-handed, and that's a left-handed camera. It winds on the left, and it was great to use. Easy to use. And it had accessories that any gadget guy would love. That was the model I got when I was a kid. Now, these are called vest pocket Exactas. They don't fit anybody's vest pocket. What they do is they take vest pocket film, which is 127, and they use that for a film size. These, you find these at flea markets all the time, and they're always way overpriced. It's a film pack camera. You can't get film for them. None of them are worth anything. $20, $10, and you see them at $100, and people pay that. It drives me nuts. My personal favorite camera is the Hasselblad, only because it is so well made. It is absolutely amazing construction. I've had three, and I still got them. They just don't wear out. The only problem is, with digital, who shoots film now? Charlie Evans. Now, this guy, you'll recognize this. Charlie, I met him when he was older, and he was in his 80s, I guess, when I met him. He took some really interesting photographs of New York City, and you can see that he would get to wherever he had to be to take those pictures in New York City, mostly construction pictures. Ooh. Hold on. Oh, he's not supposed to be there. That's okay. Yeah, it's amazing when you lift your head up, isn't it?
Well, I saw it earlier.
Yeah, I know. Kodak 35, Army camera. That's why it's green. Not sure who the designer was. I don't think it was Teague, because Teague always complained that it was one of the ugliest cameras ever built, and it got changed into having a rangefinder on it so you could tell how far stuff was, and it looked like that. It's not handsome. It's like, let's add this to it, and they splotched something on the front. Not a good looking camera. And that gear on the front for focusing, that will take your skin off. Yeah, not good. Now the chrome one, I think, is kind of nice looking, but it came with a cheap lens. And the earlier one, that's an early one, I should have had that in different order. I'm glad you guys laughed. Squirrel pictures always crack me up. Yeah, they just added stuff to that. Oh my gosh. Another little Art Deco camera. It's an Ansco camera. Yep. Little 127. Bakelite. Bakelite was very cheap. Bakelite was just, it wasn't much to it. Ah, Kodak Bullseye. Remember on the back of a camera you had a little red window that you rolled the number up to? Well, the Blair Camera Company in Boston had the patent on that window. And George Eastman really thought that was really cool. And he wanted that window. So he bought the company and produced the Kodak Bullseye number 2 in Boston at the Blair Company. They just changed the embossed, the handle was embossed and there was a silk screened name on the inside of the camera. They just changed that and they kept on production with it. That's a Bantam. Is that a flash Bantam? Yeah, it is. They call that a flash Bantam because you could buy a flash unit that would attach to and use flash bulbs. Didn't have a flash built into it. More Art Deco. This is the 50s when things started going wrong. The camera is not pretty. They don't age well. The leather peels off. And those darn Phillips screws on the front. Just, it bothers me. Another, oh, this is the Bantam special with the original German shutter. There it is, closed up tight. It is. Yeah, it is. Yeah. Teague did this one. This is something. Somebody photoshopped this.
Oh.
And I just love it. I think it is so cool. Kodak did try their skill at coming out with a very high-end camera. They had the Extra and the Extra 2. Out of the shop, out of the factory, neither one of them worked. They just, if you find one that works, you are so lucky. They're expensive to get fixed. There's a couple guys in the country that specialize in them. There are a lot of them around, believe it or not. And they were spring wound. So you took a picture and they would wind up the film by itself. But it didn't. It wasn't successful. It wasn't like the Leica. In fact, look at all the knobs on it. It had interchangeable back so you could switch film mid-roll. Neat camera. Oh, I didn't edit it. Okay. 1950s, more brownies. Built in, or not with a built-in flash, with an add-on flash. A little retina there. Retinas are big-time collectibles now. That's a very early one. That's from about 1934. A little bit later, 1950s. I have one of these. It takes 1.7 and it's got really sharp lenses. You can keep it in my pocket and take pictures with it and process it. It was one of the sharpest little cameras. And it wasn't supposed to be. It was an inexpensive camera. It was a $7 camera when it was there. Another brown little Hawkeye. Hawkeye was the name of the building where the lenses were made, the Hawkeye Lens Works in Rochester. And Brownie, you guys didn't remember what a Brownie was? What was a Brownie?
I think everybody had a seat.
Oh, no.
Girl Scouts were directly eating.
No, a Brownie was a little character that looked like a Christmas elf. Okay? Yeah, that's where the name came from. And they made reflection, single lens reflection, didn't they? And another band from that. That's not a flash. That's a regular thing. Oh, I got it. Another Art Deco front on it. I don't know if you're So I said, okay, look at the lens. I don't know if I get dizzy or not. Okay, now we got Edison and we've got Henry Ford. We've got Edison and we've got George Eastman. Edison, of course, absolutely invented the motion picture. Nobody else had done anything like that. And he needed somebody to make his film for him. And that's where he turned to George Eastman. The 35mm film came out prior to like the Leica 35mm camera came out in 1918. It was 1920 when it was introduced publicly, and it wasn't built as a camera to take pictures. It was built as a device to test the speed and sensitivity of motion picture film, because film varied from batch to batch. And you could be watching a silent film, and the scene wouldn't change, yet it would get brighter. And that was because the film sensitivity was good. So the Leica was designed to test film first. That's the world's largest camera, used to photograph a train. And the lens actually still exists. The camera does not. The lens is out in the museum in Iowa. Obviously. Now, this is the company that I work for, L.F. Deardorff & Sons in Chicago, Illinois. If you saw a Sears and Roebuck catalog in the 50s and 60s, and we all did, almost all the photographs taken were taken with that style camera. They were taken in studios in Chicago that had what are called shooting galleries. And the galleries were four stories tall. They were equipped with lighting. And they would build a house set inside without a roof. They'd build a whole house, living room, bathroom, everything. And they would take the camera and they would photograph over the living room scene. And photograph photograph the living room, the kitchen, whatever. And that's the type of camera that's 11 by 14 studio here. This is the type of photography that Deardorff was famous for. This was done by Hedrick Blessing in Chicago. If you ever see black and white pictures of the Chicago World's Fair, they're all taken by Hedrick Blessing with a Deardorff. Now we get to Margaret Berkowitz. Margaret Berkowitz is one of my favorite photographers, always has been. And she photographed everything. She photographed the Philadelphia Western out from 69th Street to Media, Pennsylvania. She photographed pigs in 1929 with that big camera on the tripod. That's the camera that shot that. She did World War II duty. She photographed during the Korean War, she photographed with Nikon, because Nikon gave her the camera to use, and they did that with a lot of photographers. Deardorff were on a postage stamp. I did a repair on that camera about a year ago. Sold it on eBay about 5 years ago. And then we go to a larger format, the Leica, a pretty popular camera among the wealthy. Nikon from the 50s, 70s, late 70s. And believe it or not, that's a new Nikon. They came out with a rangefinder, reissued the S3 rangefinder about 5 years ago because there was such a demand. And because they needed it. I really don't think there was a demand. I think they just made it smart. And then we get American-made 35mm cameras. That's a Perfex. made in Chicago. Hard to describe it. I got one up there. You'll see it. It's really hard to describe. It's chrome and black, not well done, but it's the first 35 millimeter camera in the country. It made in the United States to have a focal point shot. Then somebody, again, an industrial designer, went to the perfect and said, let's straighten this camera out. And they rounded the edge of the camera. Rolling flexes, they were, they're from Germany. That's a large one. That takes 1.2 film instead of 1.2. And then you get these limited edition ones, because they make 500 of them, just so wealthy people can buy them. It's the only reason. I got one of those. What do you have? Sometimes. And I do mean sometimes. And what it is Adorama and B&H Photo in Chicago, or in New York, will do a batch run of 127 every couple of years, and they'll have it in stock. So yes, you can. You better be processing yourself, because there's not a lab around that's going to say, oh, sure, bring it in. Because they're going to go, huh? And so yes, you can. And there's 127, 616, 116. They tried 828, which was 35 millimeter in width, but with a paper backing, and it would only take 8 pictures per roll for a BAM style. And that didn't go over too well. I saw a sale on B&H that they were selling out of their color negative films. I have a feeling. Got one up there. That is the first camera with a built-in flash, called a Spark. And it looks like a blink get a camera. That was my mom's camera, Argus 75. Now, believe it or not, that's a tintype camera. It's in Afghanistan. It was photographed by a photographer who's a friend of mine. It's still in use. So if you want to have an instant picture done, you stand in front of the temple, you stand in front of the mosque, you get your picture taken, and about 20 minutes later, the guy hands you a tintype camera, or a tintype image. Tintypes were actually available in Philadelphia and in New York up until about 63. When Polaroid came, and Polaroid kind of took it over. I happen to like the name of that one, BioFlex. I don't know if it has to do with digestion or what, but I like the name for that. Now we get into some cameras called a Buccaneer. Does that make that camera better? Okay. And then there's the Corsair, not named after the airplane, named after the sailing ship. These are made in Chicago by Universal Camera, or Univex. Again, a camera that never took a sharp picture. That was the Univex Mercury. That's a Mercury 1. They it was a half-frame camera, so it would take 72 pictures on a 36-millimeter roll. The problem is that you could only buy their film, because the set wouldn't fit in only their camera, and that didn't work out too well. So the Mercury 2 was made probably the same year, and that took 35 millimeter film. Now we're going to get into pictures that, why do you buy a dress? Because it looks nice, and it looks nice because a good camera took the picture. Most of these pictures, the Jonathan Logan ads, were all done on 8x10 geared doors in Chicago in the 50s and 60s. There's Ansel Adams with a Deerdorf. He hated the camera, and I don't have a clue why he's got that picture. I've got a letter in my archives from him to the company saying, why don't you do this, this, and that to the camera? He was trying to make it into a Kodak version of it. And Deardorff wrote back saying, because our customers like it the way they are. That was the end of it. That's what he was using. He was using a, for a while, he was using an aluminum sensor, which was very lightweight. Got blown around the wind a lot. There's Ansel on top of it. His next car he had a Packard, a Woody Packard like that, and it had jacks built into the back on the frame. You could jack and stabilize the camera, or stabilize the platform on the frame of the car, so it didn't wobble. Another shot done in Chicago. If you notice, everything, a view camera like a Deardorff can be set up with a little front tilt on the lens, so everything is in focus on that picture. If you notice, the front cloth around the crib is in sharp focus, and the back is in sharp focus. Yep. A politically incorrect doll too. I just noticed. I didn't see that till just now. Edward Weston, another guy I admire. He was a good photographer. That's him later on. I know where that camera is, but I didn't sell it. Okay. Started with a photograph and colored. Again, another photograph showing the type of advertising that you needed. And then my version. Again, all shot with Deardorff too. Typical scene with a mob of press photographers shooting with speed graphics. These guys could change film and just shoot like one every 15 seconds, which is phenomenal for a camera that size. I like that shot. This is Joel Meyerowitz. Joel's a friend of mine. That's the World Trade Center behind him. And he got hired to document it after it came down. I talked to him third day in. I fixed that camera that summer and did a clean lube and adjust on it. And I called him up. And I do this to all my customers. I called him up. I said, how's it going? And he was crying, and I didn't know why. And I said, Joel, you okay? He goes, yeah, I'm fine. I said, where are you? He goes, I don't know if he used the term ground zero or not, but he said, I'm at the site. He said, I'm at the site, that's it. And I said, I can imagine. And I told him, I said, well, you know, give me a call if you need some help with it. Anything wrong, I'm here. This is Ken Ruizu. That was a custom-made camera that L.F. Deardorff made for him, 14 by 17 in size. He likes that format. There's Margaret on top of the Chrysler Building. Yeah, isn't that fun? Pardon me? Oh, there's an inside... There's an inside thing. She's in a hatch. Yep, there's a stainless steel hatch, or not stainless, that's a nickel alloy that is really expensive. How many recognize that?
Oh, yeah.
Yep. Okay. And there's Charlie Ebbets, who took the picture. And there's Charlie Ebbets again. There's the camera used. There's that thing from the Industrial Revolution when it was traveling around the country. It's in New York there. And there's the original. Isn't that cool? Yeah. Guys, just go out on a beam and sit down and have lunch. I know, I get the, I know, me too. Okay, now, this is a shot that was shot in Chicago, and this picture just cracked me up, because the first thing I saw was a lady pulling the girdle down, okay, because, boy, do I remember my mom doing that. Oh my God, you know, she'd go over to some place in the corner and tug, you know. And of course, that one doesn't need it. But again, that type of photography was shot on large format. That one also was. All the ivory soap stuff was done in Chicago. And that's kind of cool, because if you look carefully, nope, not the same person, but the same color scheme. The little kid, blonde hair, blue eyes. Yeah. Well, you see what I'm getting at. I mean, it all ties in. Now that's interesting. On that screen, my screen, she's got blue eyes here and blue eyes there. Okay, photo again. This is all large format that was done in Chicago. Yep. Okay, now we're talking. We talk about drawings done from photographs. Then we talk about real photographs that have been highly retouched. And then a real photograph. And house dresses. Sunbeam. Sunbeam was, the toaster was designed by Raymond Loewy. And, oh, it's very Art Deco. Oh, just reeks of it. Now, the only reason I got that in there, that thing looks like it's moving at 100 miles an hour. You know? Look at the side view of that thing. Just, I love that design. Again, advertising photography. And finally, this is Ouija. Ouija was a New York City photographer who literally always had the cigar in his mouth. I don't want to show his pictures because they're pretty graphic. Usually dead bodies, okay? And he took gangland murders in Chicago, or in New York City. Yeah, they were pretty gross. His camera is at the George Eastman House in Rochester, New York. And a friend of mine who's a curator there, Todd, I gave a talk on Deerdorf cameras at Photo History 9. And after my talk, I put my cameras back in the car and wandered in to hear a couple more speeches. And when we got done, we had about an hour and a half. And we were invited over to the mansion and go down to the basement, and they've got they got thousands and thousands of cameras down there and images and stuff. And I asked him, I said to him, Todd, you got Ouija's camera? And he goes, oh God, you asked for that camera. And I said, why? And he goes, you'll see. And he gave me a pair of white gloves to handle. Okay, so I put the white cotton gloves on. And he opens up this locker, and the locker, all their lockers have a rubber gasket around them, so they're airtight. Opens up this locker, and all I smell are cigars. Oh. And the camera reeks. Still. Okay, this is part of my camera collection, and what these are pretty much consumer cameras that an average person would go out and buy. There's a few professional models in here. The the bulk of anybody's camera collection is consumer cameras. The few people that collect the high-end stuff, well, I can't afford some of that stuff. There's no way. There are Leica cameras out there that are in the $60,000 to $80,000 price range, which I think is just kind of silly. You know, it's a camera. Just, you know, what the heck? But I got a variety of cameras here. Everything from your common box camera to that's 1920 something to a Kodak Flexo, which is a bullseye camera, by the way. It was made by Blair originally. And to a 5x7 single lens reflex there. But I started collecting, like I said, when I was about 9 or 10 years old, and I started collecting box cameras, because you go to an antique store and for a dollar you could buy a box camera, and that kept me quiet in the car on the way home, okay, except for the sound of me doing this. And my dad would go, "Would you stop that?" "No, Dad, I like doing it." But anyway, so there's a variety of cameras. I started a number of years ago. Oh, gosh, when was it? It was about 20 years ago. I started buying cameras that were built the year I was born. That's my specialty. 1954, okay? Yeah, right. So little Perfex 55. In fact, this one here is a model 55, but that was built in 1954. The ever popular, this is the one of the neatest cameras ever. Is the Bell & Howe Photon. It was a motor drive camera, and it does about seven and a half frames per second. It'll eat a roll of film up faster than you can count, which is kind of strange because they never made an accessory back on it that would hold more film, like a 27-foot roll. So yeah, if you get your finger on there, all of a sudden you've done 36. Well, they're all different. But this camera, this was a neat camera. When they came out with this camera, they designed this during World War II, and it was $1,000. Okay, now who is going to spend a grand of post-World War II money to buy this camera? So it sat. It sat in the Bell & Howe warehouse up in Chicago, and nobody bought them. So eventually, they got remaindered out, and they went and were sold at Montgomery Ward's for about $600, and they didn't sell. They sat, and they sat, and they sat. And finally, by 1954, these cameras are now almost 8 years old, and they're new. They got sold for like $199.95, and then they went. Okay, they found the price point and they went. Are they rare? They used to say they only made 1,000 of them, and they spent $1 million to research and develop it, which would be $1,000 a piece in R&D costs. So, are they rare? Good question, because you find them on eBay all the time now. Used to be you'd find them on eBay once every month. Now there's 7 of them. And I don't believe they're rare. I really do. I think they made a lot of them. And they are now showing up. The unfortunate thing is that they're being sold anywhere from $1,600 to $2,000. And nobody's still buying them. Okay? Yeah. My aunt gave me this one day. And this is the one that Raymond Loewy designed. It has a flip-up mechanism. Yeah, it is. Flip-up mechanism that folds the doors up here. Again, industrial design. I love it because everything's real smooth on it. It's modern looking, 1955. You know, it's kind of a slick looking camera. I started collecting Nikon rangefinders also about, well, again, this was a birthday present to me, built in 1954. This was 10 years ago. 8 years ago? Yeah, 8 years ago. It's a Nikon S2. It was, we were still shooting a lot of film though. Film was still, you know, a viable thing to have. And I saw it on eBay. It was the right price. It ended at an odd time in the morning, like 4 o'clock in the morning, which is usually pretty good because you can get people prices that way. And I stayed up and I was watching. Okay, fine. And it didn't sell. And I thought for sure somebody would snap it up. So I emailed the guy through eBay and I said, you know, I'll give you, he had about $100 to buy. And I emailed him and I said, I'll give you $100 less. I think $300 for the body. And he said, okay, fine. And I PayPal'd him and got the thing. And took it on a cruise. And and I took it and I took another S on the cruise. This is S2, S, and S. And one weighed about 8 ounces more. And it was miserable hanging on my neck. Okay, and I said, nope, I put that camera away and just was done with it. But I started collecting cameras that belong to somebody. And that's always kind of, it's an iffy situation. Like Martin Furtwine, the big 8x10 there, the smaller Graflex there, and that Nikon S sitting there. I believe the Nikon S was hers, that one that was in the picture there, the GX2 on. Remember Dr. Milt Rosenberg on WGN? The guy who I worked for in Chicago, John Beard, or Jack, he got an invitation to be on the show one night, on the phone in the state. So you're always on the phone. He got an invitation, and he calls me up that night, and he goes, Ken, I want you to call up and ask certain questions. Okay? So I'm sort of like, okay, what? And he told me, and I knew all these stories. I was a historian of the company, so I knew all these stories, but being the shill, which is exactly what I was. Okay, fine. So I called up. Rosenberg had on a violin maker, a bookbinder, somebody who did bookbinding and did marbleizing of bookends, which I love doing that. That's so cool. And then he, because he made wood cameras like they always did in Chicago. Okay. So he fit in well with these two other people. In fact, I think it was the topic was made in Chicago, the topic of the show. Anyway, I called up and I get this producer on the line and he said, hey, you know, what do you want to talk about? And I told him and he says, oh, that's pretty specific. And I'm thinking, yeah, real specific. I was told what to say. Anyway, and about 10 minutes later, I got on and I asked Jack this question and asked another question. Jack answers these stories, you know, and that was pretty much it. Well, about a week goes by and I get a call at home from this lady I got a call from the producer of the show, the radio show, asking me if this lady could call me personally. And I said, sure. You know, I could care. The next day this lady called me up and she says, well, I'd like to have you come over to see some stuff. And I said, oh, where do you live? And she lived in Michiana Shores. You know where that is? I never knew it existed. Okay, I did not know any, Really? Okay. I thought it was Michigan City and New Buffalo, and that was it. And I find Michiana Shores, and I go in there, and as I'm driving around, I got my mom and my two kids in the car who are young and rambunctious. My son was 4, my daughter was 8. She could pretty much sit and be by herself, but my son was a little bit squirrely. And I go to the house, and the house up there, there's a whole bunch of them. They look like log cabins, but they're not. They take a log about that big, they turn it round, and they split it, and that's the siding of the house. Okay, and there's dozens of them. They're all over. They're mostly kind of an oxide red, and I'm finally find her house, and I go up to the door, and I knock on the door, and it was in the spring or fall. Nice weather. It wasn't real hot. And I hear this real feeble voice, "Come on in." And I'm like, okay. And I go in, and this place is as dark as you can be. Just pitch black. And there's a wing chair sitting in the middle of the living room, and there's some big band music playing. And I thought, oh my God, I'm in some sort of weird dream here. You know, really, it was just a little odd. And I walk in, and I said, "Hello." And all of a sudden, I see this hand shoot up from the chair. You know, and I literally am thinking the Bates Motel.
Yeah.
You know, I just didn't know what was going on. And I walk in, and I walk over, I stand in front of her, and she puts her hand out away from me. And I walked over and I shook her hand. I realized she's blind. She can't see. And we chatted. She told me to grab a chair. She didn't realize the chair was like near the wall over there. But I drug this chair over and I sat down across from her. And we started talking about Chicago photography. She had been a model in the 30s. And I couldn't find any pictures of her. I really wanted to find her. She was a model that would fit in as a model now. She was that person. And I'm talking to her husband. I've heard of her husband. Her husband was 25 years older than she was. It was a scandal there. The old guy married a young model. And but we're talking about Chicago photography, all the studios she's been modeling for, all the Sears and Montgomery Wards. She was doing hand, gloves, fingers, rings, shoes, all this type of stuff, okay? And then she said, "Foundation," okay? I'm thinking, what's that? Oh, bras and panties. Yeah, right, okay. Anyway, so we're talking, and I hear my daughter screaming, and I knew I had to kind of speed it up. And she goes, "Is that your family out there?" I said, "Yeah." And she goes, "Well, you've been in here quite a while. You don't care about them, huh?" I said, "No, my mom's out there." I said, "It's okay." And I said, "My son, if he's got to, you know, we've been around trains and tractors forever, so he's got to take a pee, he'll go in the back. You know, he's fine." And she started laughing. She goes, "My husband did that too." Anyway, we got talking. She goes, "I want to show you something." And she points over to the closet. Now, her walls were knotty pine siding in the house, okay? The walls were this thick. They were really, really, really thick. And I couldn't find the covered door she's talking about because it's all the same. What was the giveaway was the finger hole. Put your finger in, you pull the door open, okay? No knobs, just finger. And there were pictures on these doors, the paint, you know, hanging pictures and stuff. So I pull the door open. And I look down at the bottom first, and I see two wood boxes, whiskey crates, and they had cameras and stuff. And then I looked up, and on the left and on the right were gallon, commercial-sized gallon bottles of Smirnoff vodka and Jack Daniel's whiskey. And all I could think of is, I know why she's blind. You know, this is nuts. Anyway, so I pull these cameras out and I drag them over on the carpet and put them down, and she starts telling me about them, and And I pulled the 8x10 out, and I said, oh, I said, this is a 1929 or 30 8x10 deer door. And she goes, oh, that's still in there? I go, yeah. And she goes, that was Burke White's. And I go, Margaret Burke White? She goes, well, we called her Maggie. And I'm like, really? And I pulled the Graflex out, and she goes, that was hers too. Now, there's 20 years difference in the two. Okay. And I pulled the Nikon out. And she goes, that was probably hers. And I'm like, well, what is going on here? I couldn't quite figure things out. Turns out Margaret Burke White, when she would go out on a photo assignment, she would generally buy a camera near or close to the photo assignment. Okay? So she bought an 8x10 from Deerdorf. I've heard the story about when she bought that camera. And she was a nobody. I mean, she was just a photographer. She wasn't, and that was kind of strange for a woman shooting 8x10. Okay, this is 1929. This is not, you know, normal. And she had a job to photograph the stockyards in Chicago for the pigs. And she was bound and determined to do it on a large format because there wasn't anything else that she could do it with. Anyway, the story goes, and this is a story that has been publicized all over, is that when she shot the job, a pig rogue pig charged her. And she took the camera and swung it with the tripod at the pig and broke the camera. And she went to the insurance agency and claimed a loss. Okay. Well, she also owed the people, she owed the Dye family, this is the lady who I was got these cameras from, Mrs. Dye, Shirley. Her husband had a darkroom, and she was Burke White was using the darkroom in Chicago, and skipped out on the rent, but she left the camera and the tripod and some other stuff. Okay, so that's how she paid the rent that she owed. Okay, and she got the money to buy a new camera. Okay, then she did the same thing in '46 with the little Graflex. She shot a job in Chicago and left the Graflex. And in 52, when she came to do the same thing, because after all, if you're going to do it once, you can just keep doing it. And she left an icon up there. Now, this is a studio in Chicago that did not shoot 35 millimeter. They shot 5x7 portraits. Okay, that's all they ever shot. 5x7 portraits, vertical or horizontal in a group. And I got that camera too. But that doesn't have any great story behind it. You know, but they had a wonderful darkroom. And I've seen a picture of their darkroom, and it was pretty, it was right up there. So those are the first cameras I ever had that belonged to someone. It also, in researching the cameras, I started finding out a whole lot of people had Burke White cameras because they were all over. And if you look at pictures of her on the internet, she doesn't have the same camera twice. There's different cameras in every single picture of this woman. Okay, so she had a little deal going. You know, she knew, and there's no computers, there's no paper trail, there's no nothing. It's just whatever, what it is. Then about, oh, I guess it was about 15 years ago, a friend of mine who worked for the Gary Post, he comes over to the house and he's got a bag of old Nikons. Okay, and he goes, you want these? And I said, sure. And I took them and put batteries in them and fired them up, and some of them worked, some of them didn't. But a couple of them looked promising. And this was one of them. Battery died. Anyway, a photographer by the name of David Hume Kennerly was a Nikon user. He was Jerry Ford's press photographer. Did all of his photography. And when he wore these cameras out, he would trade them into a Washington, D.C. or New York studio or New York camera shop and they would go into the used pile, and they would go out. And I checked the serial number, and the serial number matched one that he owned. So this is one of his. I don't know what pictures it ever took. I have no idea. The guy had five of these things hanging around his neck. Okay, so who knows? Who knows? You guys got any questions? I've been doing all the talking.
How do you prove that what you've got belongs to
you? Mostly by serial numbers. Okay, mostly by serial numbers. And Nikon is pretty good with keeping serial numbers and records of who it belonged to and its repair history. Okay, so when I called Nikon up, I got a friend who works at Nikon who bought a camera from me one time. And I've got a lot of people, I've got a lot of connections now because I work with Geardorf's, that it's just a matter of giving them a call, giving them the number, waiting a few days and waiting a month or so, maybe you get an email and say, nope, this didn't belong to anybody, just, you know, or yeah, this belonged to, you know, David Hume Kennerly. And so it's mostly that. Hasselblad is they're like fanatics on serial numbers. Okay, I mean just nuts. Pardon me?
They're German.
No, they're Swiss.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, or Swedish. Yeah. Swedish, not Swiss. They're Swedish. And I've got a Supreme wide angle camera, an SWA, that 1954, real early serial number, 2-digit serial number. Okay, so I know it's real early. I think it's SWA 28, and I thought, why not? And I called them up, and this you couldn't call New York, the Hasselblad New York. You had to call Hasselblad Sweden. So I called Hasselblad Sweden, and I got this person who spoke English better than I did, and I gave him the number, and I got a nice letter in a nice airmail package, probably a week later, that told me that this camera belonged to Time Life Studios. It was used for Life magazine photography. It was in the repair shop almost half of its life because it wasn't a good camera. I mean, they hadn't perfected it yet,
right.
Okay? And all that made the difference there nowadays was the lubrication. I put a modern lube in there, and it fires every single time and winds perfect every time. But back then, they had a lube that had too much solvent in it, and it would dry out. The solvent would evaporate and dry out, and you press the button, and it might not return on you because it's not slippery enough. It might be fine for the first 6-8 months, maybe a year, but after that, it'll start slowing up. Put a modern lube in there, and it was just fine. And you could see that when I took it apart the first time, you could see the handmade parts that replaced the original factory parts. And they asked for a picture of it. And then they asked for the camera back. Okay, they said, oh, we'll give you a new SWA. I don't want a new SWA. I want this one. This one has a history.
Right.
I know what pictures it took. I can guess what they were because you look in those 1954, 55 Time magazine or Life magazines, and there's always a picture that was shot by, what's his name? I want to say Collier. You got the Collier lot. Mm-hmm. And what was the game show host? Bud Collier.
Collins.
Bud Collier had the Price is Right or something. Or he had a show on TV, and he was a photographer for Life magazine, and he used that camera because he always had a wide angle shot. So I know that camera probably took those pictures. Yeah, yeah. So yeah, you can track stuff down. And with the internet, sometimes it's easier and sometimes it's harder. You know, because sometimes people, they don't want to tell you anything. They're like, oh, it's a family secret. Why? You know. So yeah, you can find a lot of stuff out. Not too hard. And I've got with Deerdorf, I own the serial number books, so I know. Yeah, yeah.
Now they are out of business now.
Sorta. I bought the assets. I bought the tangible assets from the company, which is all the wood and all the metal. I didn't get the company name. Another guy got the company name, and he's producing a camera, but he's having a hell of a time getting parts made. So he's kind of struggling along too. You know, I was lucky that when Deerdorf went out of business, I contacted every single company that made parts for them, because a lot of those parts are stamped, okay, and they're done on stamping presses, okay, and I bought all of the excess parts that they had for dirt cheap, you know.
Who else is going to use them?
Exactly, yeah. exactly. The unfortunate thing is I've run out of some parts, and when I went to have new parts made, they threw the tooling away, or they scrapped the tooling out. But that's okay, because now we got laser cutting. Okay, and I can have my son draw up a part in about 20 minutes on CAD, send it to him, get a sample 2 days later, and put it in my brake and bend it to the shape I need, and say, yeah, this is fine. So it's so much easier. You know, a typical stamping die would run $10,000, a cheap one, and I can't afford that. And anymore, they're not. I'm fixing cameras. I'm putting bellows on them. I'm not doing full refinishings right now. Not as many as I used to. You know, I used to do a couple dozen a year, and that just isn't happening right now.
Now, is that because
digital
business isn't there? Or
no, it's digital. It's digital. Oh, I'm interested in doing it. It just is. It's digital, and digital technology has gotten so good. Now, I mean, it's scary good. It's scary good. But who are using these cameras, the 8x10s, are people who want to go out and get away from it all. I mean, you know, they want to revert to the old way of doing things, and they want to go hiking with them, and they, you know, things like that. And I have no interest in hiking. I can hardly walk from my car into here. My legs hurt so bad. But the photographers that shoot with them, you either admire their work or you go, huh? There's Hashimoto, who's one of the photographers that shoots with a camera I built years ago, and he does seascapes. Okay, and the Art Institute in Chicago had a whole display of his seascapes. And I'm not kidding you. They're light on top and they're dark on the bottom, and there's no horizon, and they look like they're out of focus. And you look at it and you go, huh? I like detail. I like detail. I like mechanical things. I like things that have, you know. In Chicago, the Carson Perry Scott Company. I should have brought an example of the picture. Carson Perry Scott Company in Chicago, down on the second sub-level basement, has three stationary steam engines in a row with generators hooked up to them, because they used to power the building. That's what provided the electricity for that building. And they're still sitting there. And I photographed them one time, and they are so cool looking. The unfortunate thing is the freight elevator that brought them in is no longer in existence. So they're always going to be there. And the Wrigley Powerhouse is still in existence in Chicago. And you'd never recognize it if you saw it. I mean, it's just a building downtown. Stacks are cut off, the smokestacks are cut off. But there's a guy that goes in there and polishes all the brass on them. And I want to get in there and photograph them sometimes, because those are big engines. Those stationary engines are as big as this room is, with 12 and 15 foot flywheels and generators connected to them. And I want to get in there so bad. I've gotten in, I just haven't done it. And I don't want to do it with this, because that looks too chintzy. But if I do it with an 11 by 14, the guy will take me seriously. He'll go, oh yeah, sure, come on in. That's fine. Well, I'm glad all six of you were here.
Well, thanks, Kevin.